All right, let's go to Galatians chapter 3 in your Bibles. Hope you have your Bibles with you. If you don't, you can raise your hand and one of our volunteers will be happy to bring you one. You can borrow it this morning or you can keep it if you don't have one or just would like a new one. It's our gift to you. You can just raise your hand and Mike will bring it to you right now. We've been going through Galatians for the last several weeks. We were in a series a few weeks ago called Rumors of God, listening to Paul be very defensive about his position of authority, his position of calling to be an apostle and carry the good news, the gospel message, the truth of God's grace and love to the Gentiles. And then we shifted from his defense to his offense, and we've been in a new series called Focus, where Paul begins to come into, with clarity, what the gospel really is, making sure the Galatians get it without a shadow of a doubt. And so we've been talking about the last couple weeks, and we've seen a lot of comparisons from really the beginning of what it looks like to live in the law, which was what these outsiders, these Judaizers were coming in and trying to get the churches in Galatians to do, to say, hey, if you really want to be a Christ follower, you can't just believe, right? You can't just have faith in Jesus. You also have to do all these things, and that will earn your way to God. And Paul's argued many times that earning our way to God is not right, that is not the gospel. It's a gift, a free gift, by faith. And so he's going to drive that point home today. Now, I've been thinking about that comparison, really, and read a great, just an illustration about inheritance. We're going to talk about inheritance here in a minute, too, as part of the promise of God. But does anybody ever don't raise your hand, because I don't want anybody to ask you after the service to borrow money, but has anybody come into money? Like, has anybody, got an inheritance? Don't raise your hand, because somebody will ask you to go out. Hey, take me to lunch. No. Come into some, maybe you got an email from somebody in Nigeria. No, I'm just kidding. Don't do that. Just never do that. Or those Facebook posts about the company that decided to give away all those profits. Those are not true. But like legitimate inheritance. Someone said, "Hey, you have just this person passed away, or this happened, or something happened, and you just got just free money. You didn't have to do anything for it. It's just a gift, right? It was a promise. It was true." Now there's a movie, and I'm dating myself a little bit, even though it was kind of old when I first saw it. Brewster's Millions, right? You remember that? Yeah, which would be, I guess, Brewster's Billions if it was truly going to be like modernized a little bit. But Brewster's Millions, Richard Pryor was the star. It's not a clean movie. I'm not recommending you see this movie. It was on TV like back in the day when everything was bleeped out, right? Or it was cut out. So in this movie, he receives this inheritance, and it's ridiculous amounts of money, but there's a catch. The catch is he has to go out and spend a large portion of it in a certain amount of time or give it away, and he has to get rid of a whole bunch of it to earn any of it, So it's either zero or this, but he has to do all this work to get it. Well, that's not a real inheritance, right? It makes for a great movie, but it's not a real inheritance. It's not a real promise. It's not a real gift. Because a gift you give someone, you're not giving it to them expecting really anything in return. You're not giving it to them and saying, oh, wait, I'll give this to you if you do X, Y, and Z. Well, that's not a gift. You've then earned that, right? It's more of a wage, okay? If you do this, then I will pay you this. Even if millions of dollars is a really good wage for a few hours of work. So God says that he has given a promise, right? And Paul's going to make this clear in just a second. He has made a promise, and it's not something that he can go back on. It's not something he's going to change his mind on. But it does beg some questions, because the promise he made was with Abraham, right, and the people and the descendants that would come from him, and the promise that a Savior would come from his offspring. That promise was made a long time before the law, but the law, so many have attached to the law to say, no, if you obey this to a T, then you can earn your righteousness. And we see Paul fighting back and forth and say, no, there's a clear difference. There's a clear difference between a promise, a gift of something that is free versus something that you have to work towards, right? To have a real inheritance, to have a real gift, a real promise, the only thing you have to do is believe it's true. Someone called you on the phone and said, hey, someone in your family recently passed away. I've got this gigantic check that was in his will for you. Come get it, right? It's yours. Well, all you have to do is really believe that that's true and then go get it, right? If they call you and they say, hey, this person passed away, you're in the will, he's going to give you this money, but you have to, you know, work 7 years in this company, and you have to do all these different things. And it's like, well, that's not an inheritance, it's not a gift, right? You're working for whatever that amount of money is. And that is really the difference between grace, free gift, and the law, which says you have to obey, right? The promise, you just have to believe in, but the law, you have to obey. A gift, you just have to believe and receive. But if the law is the way, then you ultimately have to obey it and obey it to a T, which we've talked about how that's not possible. So Paul jumps into this. We need to jump right in. Paul's been talking about that. We talked about that last week. And just to catch you up just a little bit, we talked about how when Paul begins his offense, when he begins to clarify the gospel and the justification by faith, he says, look, there's a bigger picture about who God is. Don't focus, don't lose the bigger picture for a smaller one. Right? Don't miss who God is just because you think you have to do these things here today to earn his favor. That's not what faith is. And then last week we said faith is more than forgiveness. Faith is more than facts, right? You just believe something that's not complete. Facts can get in the way sometimes if you think that these are the things you have to do to earn your way. Faith is deeper than that. Faith is absolute trust, right? And today we're going to see that God's love is not for sale. We're going to see that God made a promise a long time ago, and he's not going to change. He's not going to change from the promise he made back to Abraham. It's the same promise when the law was written. It's the same promise that exists today. There's no change. There's no change. So Paul dives in, he's continuing his conversation, and he says in verse 15, to give a human example, just so that they understand where he's coming from, to give a human example, brothers, even with a man-made covenant, no one annuls it or adds to it once it has been ratified. And he's talking about a will, right? If there's an inheritance involved and the will has been written, it doesn't matter if the conditions have changed. This is true in today's life, right? Because if you write a will and you want to give one child X number of dollars because they're more responsible than this other child, and you give them less amount of money or however the will works, and you pass away, and the day after you pass away, the one who you thought was responsible turns out to be not responsible. It doesn't change the fact that the will's done, right? It's written in stone. It's set. You can't change it just because the conditions have changed, just because who you wrote in your will you thought was a responsible one ends up not being responsible. It doesn't matter. The contract is done. So that's Paul saying. No one annuls it or adds to it once it's been ratified. Now, verse 16. The promises were made to Abraham and to his offspring. It does not say, and to offsprings, referring to many, but referring to one, and to your offspring, who is Christ. This is what I mean. The law, which came 430 years afterward, does not annul a covenant previously ratified by God, so as to make the promise void. For if the inheritance comes by the law, it no longer comes by promise, but God gave it to Abraham by a promise. And this is the key question. So we just talked about all that. Paul just said it all right there. God made a promise. The law doesn't nullify it. Well, then here's the question. Why then the law? Why the law? He answers it. Look what he says. It was added because of transgressions until the offspring should come, right? That's the Christ to come. The offspring should come to whom the promise had been made. And it was put in place through angels by an intermediary. Now, an intermediary implies more than one, but God is one. That last part there, there's a little bit of confusion. It just means that when God spoke the promise to Abraham, he spoke directly to Abraham. When God spoke the promise to Moses, he was telling Moses to speak for him. And so he had the intermediary there to speak between him and the people. But it doesn't change that it's still a message from God. And even in the presence of angels, it doesn't make it different, right? And it's still one God. It's still the same message. Promise is still the same. But it does beg the question, why the law? I mean, Paul knows that the promise is made to Abraham. He knows that the promise is to his offspring, not his offspring, it's not plural, it's singular. The word there means one specifically. He knows that it's speaking about the Christ. And he asks the question that we really should all be asking, why the law? Why does the law exist? We read the Old Testament, we look at the law, it's like there's a whole bunch of rules and regulations in there that's in the Bible that we believe and we're supposed to follow, but some of that stuff is crazy nuts. Why the law? And especially why the law, if 430 years prior, Abraham was given a promise that didn't have the law attached to it. The promise was a Savior will be in your offspring. You will be the father of a great nation, a nation that I will call my own people. And from this offspring will come a Messiah, a Savior, that will bring make it all right. But there's no law attached to that. So why is the law necessary? He tells us two things. And I want us to see it before we get into to the meat of this, because it'll help us understand. He gives us two reasons why the law is necessary. He says it was added because of transgressions. This is verse 19. It was added because of transgressions and until the offspring should come to who the promise had been made. So the first thing is, the law is there to reveal mistrust. And Paul talks about this in Romans 5 when he talks about how the flesh caused more transgression. Transgressions increased because of our flesh. Let me try to help you understand what I mean. I don't like doctors or needles. Okay. Thank you. I'm glad I'm not alone on this. Medicines, pills, right? I'm not a fan. Now, I'm not saying that they don't help people and there's not good things that come out of it. I'm just saying that I have a distrust for this, the medical. Now, when I get super sick or, you know, I get in a car accident because my dog chews my brakes, there's always, you know, reason to go see a doctor and get things taken care of. But I distrust doctors. Now, you may not know that unless you know me, and now, of course, I said that, and now you know that, but that's something that I can keep very internal. That's something that I don't have to tell anyone. I can just mistrust doctors, and you'll never know, right? Until one day something does happen to me, and I go see a doctor, and the doctor writes a prescription, gives me the prescription, and I throw it in the trash. Now, there's tangible evidence to my distrust. Now, there's an act of rebellion to me distrusting the doctor. And I've thrown away my fair share of prescriptions, just so you know. I the distrust, though, now is evident by my actions, right? So prior to the law, and even Paul talks about that, before the law, you know, you couldn't see what the sin was. The law reveals who truly trusts God and who doesn't trust God. The law was put in place to say, okay, let's see who really is going to have faith in me regardless. Because the people who distrust God, the people who weren't really going to follow him, the people who are going to rebel, the law is like the prescription, and they're just throwing it in the trash. Disobeying the law, or obeying the law, is not earning your way as much as it is revealing how much faith you genuinely have, how much trust you have in God, right? And it's given to a people who were extremely disobedient, who were extremely rebellious. I mean, you read their story before the law was given. He had just rescued them from years of slavery. And their response to that is to walk over the mountain and worship idols. An incredibly rebellious people. And God's like, here, okay, let's we're just going to separate the sheep from the goats. Let's just figure out who really trusts me here. Let's figure out who is genuine. Here's the law, and the law, really, the transgressions increase because the law is set, but it's done so that we can see who truly has trust and faith in God. It reveals sin. It reveals rebellion. It reveals, right, because we know, and even Moses knew, because he wrote about it in Deuteronomy 31. He said, there's no way we can meet, he's writing it down, there's no way we can fulfill this. There's no way we can accomplish this. I mean, from day one, they knew. He knew. This is impossible. And it was impossible. It wasn't meant or ever intended to change. See, if the law was put in place for us to follow, to earn our way to God, that would mean that it made his promise no longer valid. So here's the promise. When God said, I'm going to send a Savior through your offspring. If the law comes in to replace that, when God said, well, I messed up there, so here, I'm going to fix it. Here's the law. Let's change it. No. And that's what Paul said. He's saying it doesn't change anything. It doesn't make the promise void. All it does is two things. First, it reveals those who mistrust God. The second thing it does is it helps us recognize the promise when it comes. Because what does Jesus say in Matthew 5:17? He says, I have come to fulfill the law. He is the fulfillment of the law. We see and recognize who the promise is in the fact that he not only meets the law perfectly, which none of us can do, but he also fulfills the law in being the sacrifice and everything that the law demanded. You see? The law was there really as a foreshadowing of the Christ to come. So Paul wants the Gentiles, he wants us to know, he wants the Galatian churches to know and recognize that the law is there really to help us see sin, to know how dependent we are on God, and to really separate those who are truly going to have faith and trust him and those who are not, who are going to now reveal their rebellious heart, and it can't be a secret anymore. And it's also going to show us, it's also going to show us what to look for when the promise is fulfilled, the Messiah, the anointed one, the Christ, Jesus, who comes and fulfills it, right? So let's keep reading. We've answered the law, and so now we're in verse 21. Is the law then contrary to the promises of God? Certainly not. For if a law had been given that could give life, then righteousness would indeed be by the law. But the scripture, or the law, imprisoned everything under sin so that the promise by faith in Jesus Christ might be given to those who believe. Now, before faith came, we were held captive under the law, imprisoned until the coming faith would be revealed. So then, the law was our guardian until Christ came, in order that we might be justified by faith. All right, let's stop right there. There's a lot in there, too. Paul says the law can't give life because something that is dependent on a flawed people is going to fail because of the flawed people. The law is saying it's not, okay, let's go back to the original analogy. A gift, a promise, something that you can't earn. God didn't change his mind from promise to performance. He didn't turn around and say the law is something now you must do to earn your way. And the reason the law can't give life is because the law, like a wage, is something that has to be earned, it has to be obeyed. Well, it can't be obeyed completely, and so the flaw right there, the reason it can't give life is because no one can fulfill it. No one can do it. It can't give life because it's dependent on a flawed people, us, to perfectly follow it, which we can't because we're flawed. So the law can't give life because it's dependent on flawed people to follow it. Paul reiterates this in Romans 8 when he says the law is weakened because of our flesh. The law imprisons us, he says, or it locks us up under sin because our natural desire is not to follow it. So here we have a law given by God, and in its purpose to reveal sin, it also reveals that we can't follow it, we won't follow it, because naturally we have rebellion in our heart, and that's what we ultimately have to fight against. Paul reiterates that again in Romans 8, when he says that the flesh ultimately is hostile towards God. Now, it talks about the law being a guardian, and this is where we begin to really understand that the law was not intended to say that God's love was for sale, that we could change it, that he would change his mind or fix something that he thought was broken. This is how we begin to understand that it wasn't broken, that it was there to help us, to guide us. Because Paul says that the law was, we look in verse 24, the law was our guardian until Christ came. And when you see guardian, you have to think like custodial care. The word literally means tutor, right? Supervisor. It means one who is teaching or preparing for the future. And that is how we should understand the law. It helps us to know what a mature Christian would do, not as a way to earn favor with God, but as a response. When you trust God, you obey his law. That's said in 1 John, that if you love him, you obey his commandments. You don't obey his commandments to earn love because you love him. You do these things just to say thanks, just to show honor, to find some way of appreciation because you have, like we said last week, you have put your faith in the defense of Jesus and his death, burial, and resurrection, and said, I'm not putting evidence out for the judge to change his mind. I'm not putting stuff out there. I've just, my faith that Jesus' work on the cross was enough. So the law is there to give us guidance. It cannot give us inheritance. It cannot fulfill the promise. It shows us how much we need a savior, but it cannot save. Now, this is where we're going to get to the good stuff. Here we go. Verse 25. But now that faith has come, now that Messiah has come, now that Jesus has come, now that he has come and died on the cross and he was buried dead and came back to life and ascended to the right hand of the Father, now that faith has come, we're no longer under a guardian. We don't need an additional tutor, supervisor, to point to future preparation. We have the truth in Jesus. We no longer are under a guardian, for in Christ Jesus, you ready? You are all sons of God through faith. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ, you have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. There is no male and female. For you are all one in Christ Jesus. And if you are Christ, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to promise. Man, right in the middle of his letter, he just slams down the exclamation point and says, this is why I'm writing. This is what you have to get. This is the main point. If we miss this, we miss the whole thing. Now, when he's writing this, he didn't have chapters, right? But it fits right really in the middle of his letter. He goes from defending his position, defending his authority, defending the gospel and the message, and going through all of the arguments to see how he can be trusted and the apostles can be trusted and how they weren't teaching different things. And just because he wasn't in Jerusalem didn't mean that he was teaching something different from them. They were all on the same page. He had met with them. They had all agreed. Everything was right. He defends. Then he goes on the offense, and he's like, let's talk about it. Let's talk about what justification really looks like. Let's talk about the gospel. Let's talk about the good news. Let's understand that we cannot earn our way, that we cannot ever earn our way. There's nothing we can do. We must be dependent on God for salvation. He's the only one that can save us. We cannot save ourselves. And so, like we talked about last week, being justified means we recognize that we're guilty, we're sinners, okay, that we totally did it, but we're going to fight for, we're not pushing evidence out for what good we did just to try to be seen as righteous. The only way to be seen as righteous is when we put our faith in the only righteous one. We put our faith in Jesus, who did all the work for us. And we say, this is my defense. I trust in him. I trust that what he said was true. I trust that that what he did was real. I trust that he is not dead, that he came back to life. It all hinges on that. This is my faith. I trust him with my life now, the blessing of promise now and for eternity. This is my defense. And then here is what we get. Three things. He says, you are all, it's always three, thank you, it's always three. It's just true, and I don't know, it just is. You are all sons of God. That's the first one. But now that faith has come, you're no longer under a guardian, for in Christ Jesus, you are all sons of God through faith. So if you have faith, you are considered sons of God. It's a beautiful picture of redemption and adoption. And I don't know if you've ever been through an adoption or know someone who's been through an adoption, but you see a child that has no one, a child that has potentially no hope, just in the scheme of things, and someone comes in and says, this is mine. And they legally make it their own. This is now a part of my family. This is my child. And it doesn't matter blood relation. It is theirs. This is what Paul is talking about here. Not only are we justified, not only does God now not look at us as guilty, he doesn't look at us as sinner, stained by sin, but because we place our faith in Jesus and the defense that Jesus brings by the work on the cross, he now looks at us as one of his own, as a son. Now, that word specifically means son. And I'm going to be honest with you. And I'm looking at this, I had a little bit of a problem. I have often looking at that, because oftentimes you'll read, you know, where it says brother and it kind of means sibling. You can be brother, sister. You have some universal terms in there. When it talks about man, you really know it means mankind, not just men in general. But this specifically means son. And I had a problem. It's like, come on, why can't you be a daughter of God? Why does it have to be a son of God? And I read, when I was reading Tim Keller's book in Galatians, and his insight is just profound. And I'm going to share what I learned. In this particular culture, when you're talking about being a child of someone, how much inheritance does a daughter receive? Zero. Nothing. And in writing this, Paul wanted to make sure that his readers, and of course us, understand that when he's talking about being a child of God, he's not just talking about being a child. He's talking about being an heir. He's talking about being the legal heir, the son, the lead son, the one who gets the inheritance, the one who receives all the blessing. So it's not to be missed. And so, women, I don't want you to read into this like, oh, this is not gender equality. This is not a gender equality thing here, okay? This is Paul saying it is more important for you to recognize the value in this culture and this time to say son of God than just child of God, because when writing this, they would have heard son of God as meaning something and son and daughter of God as, man, that doesn't really mean anything. You with me? So he sees you not just as a child. He sees you as his head, lead son, heir to all he has. And that applies to every man and woman who has faith in him. Well, how do I know that? We're going to look at that in just a second. Here's something else to know, too. When he sees you as a son of God, and he sees you as justified, there's more, okay, than just him seeing you as righteous. Like, where does that come from? This is what Paul says. This is a beautiful picture, and you got to see this. Because he says, for you are all sons of God through faith, verse 27, for as many of you as were baptized, which is the public profession, this is what we do baptisms when people are ready to declare, hey, I've placed my faith and trust in Jesus. If you would like to do that, let's talk about that. But it's just a way to publicly symbolize that I am died to my old self and I've come back with a new life in Christ. And in this culture and generation, it would have been a way to kind of wash away and say, I'm no longer this old person. I'm now a new person in this discipline. And the discipline was baptized into Christ. But look what it says, have put on Christ. So if you've publicly declared your faith, then you have totally trusted God with your life. You have put on Christ, and your transformation may say, clothed in Christ. And I love this analogy. I love this analogy. Because it's saying, you believe in Jesus, you have faith in him. You're trusting him. And not only does the judge, as the father, does he look at you and see you as righteous, right? He sees you as righteous because you have basically put on a Jesus costume. You have clothed yourself like Jesus. So now when the judge sees you, he says, that's my son. That's my son. You clothe yourself in Christ. Now, here's why I love this analogy. Because what do clothes mean to us, right? What do clothes mean to us? Well, I know in the wintertime when I grow my beard out real big and I wear a red plaid shirt that I get lots of jokes about being a lumberjack, all right? And, you know, I mean, that's fine because I'm the one who chose the red plaid shirt, and so I accept the jokes, and it's kind of fun, right? So people identify me as a lumberjack because of the clothes that I wear. This is true. When you wear clothes, people will identify you by what you wear. If you're in a uniform at Chick-fil-A, okay, they identify you as a Chick-fil-A employee. You're not going to walk into Chick-fil-A wearing a McDonald's uniform because that's going to mess things up, right? You are identifying, like really mess things up, okay? You are identified by the clothes that you wear, okay? Why else do we wear the clothes that we wear? We wear the clothes we wear because at the end of the day, we're imitating a fashion trend or maybe a group that we want to be a part of. Right? You can see that there are certain hipsters that dress a certain way. There are some yuppie people that dress a certain way. There are other groups of people that dress a certain way, right? And you imitate those people by the clothes that you wear, right? And then what happens if you wear rags, you got dirty jeans, dirty clothes, and you look like you've been rolling in the mud, and you go get a new, fresh outfit, you look immediately like a new person, right? Clothes say a whole lot about us. Now, let's take that analogy and let's apply it to our relationship with Christ. We put on Christ and we now identify with Christ. We identify that he is our main priority, that he is who we want to be known as, that we put on Christ because we want people to look at us and go, hey, that is a Christ follower. We put on Christ because we want to imitate him. We're following his lead. We put this on because we want to be in his group. and look like we're a part of his group. And we put on Christ because we don't want to look like our old self anymore. We want to look like a new person. And we have that new life in Christ. So when it says you've put on Christ and clothed in Christ, it's not just a Jesus costume. You literally have put on his righteousness. So when the Father looks at you, he sees you as clean. He sees you as righteous. He says, that one is mine. Amen. We are all sons of God. I got to fly through these last two. Listen. You are all sons of God, but look at verse 28. There is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free, there is no male or female, for you are all one in Christ. That's the second one. You are all seen the same. Now, this doesn't take away distinctions, okay? Paul is clear, the rest of the Bible is clear. There's distinctions between male and female. We all know there are distinctions between male and female. We are not the same, right? We are definitely different. We know that there are you know, cultural differences. The people who live in America do things differently than people who live in other countries, right? There are obviously distinctions that Paul is not trying to erase. But what he's saying is that now that you have clothed in Christ, now that you've put on Christ, now that you have faith in the only one who can save you, now the divisions that divide and create corruption and destroy unity are gone. Jesus no longer looks at you, God doesn't look at you, as Jew or Greek, as master slave, as man or woman. He sees you as son of God. He sees you as one of his own, which means that the cultural differences, doesn't matter if you're Republican or Democrat, doesn't matter if you're conservative or liberal, God doesn't see that. He doesn't see it. He sees one of my own. It doesn't matter if you're wealthy or poor. It doesn't matter if you own your own business or if you're slaving away to pay the bills every week. If you have faith in him, God sees you as mine. He says, you are one of my own. And listen, male or female, this is probably the most powerful statement in this whole thing, because in this culture, women were basically property, right? There was no conversation about voting rights and equality in the pay scale. There was none of those conversations. This was men, all right, had the opportunity to lead, and if they had a woman, then she could be attached to him. That was the only way to survive. And Paul just throws the whole thing out with the bathwater. He says, no, it doesn't matter anymore, because God doesn't see man and woman. He sees child of God. He sees you as an heir, as if you were the only son, because you've put on his only son. Powerful. Here's the third one. And if you are Christ, verse 29, and if you are Christ, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to the promise. What's the promise? If you have faith, as Abraham had faith, and you're not depending on your own work and effort, and you have total confidence in the work of Christ on the cross, and confess him as Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you're clothed in Christ. And God sees you as his own. He sees you as righteous. He counts you justified. And he makes you an heir to his inheritance. He makes you an heir. We're talking about the creator of the universe. I know we say it all the time, but this is God Almighty, who has access to everything. And he's basically saying, it's yours. It's yours. That's the fulfillment of the promise is Christ. And our faith in Christ is Paul saying, we get it too. It's a free gift. It's not a performance-based faith. It's a promise-based faith. He's not going to change his plan. He's not going to renege on his promise. He didn't back then. He won't today. Because God's love is not for sale. There's nothing we can do. There's nothing we can offer. There's nothing we can try to make him change his mind or to work inside of a box that we want him to fit in. What we can offer him is faith in him. That we can focus our trust on him and him alone. So this morning, I ask you a question this morning. Are you clothed in Christ so that people see Jesus in you? Or do you represent something else? How do you identify? What do people see in you? What are things that you can do in your life to show that Christ is the center point of your faith? To show how much you believe and trust in Jesus. Listen, I can't answer that question for you. I can answer for myself, and I have a laundry list of things I can work on. Where are you this morning? We talk about focus. It comes back to faith. We focus our trust on Him to know that no matter how hard we try to manipulate the system, no matter how much we do to try to fit God in a box, to make it work out for our conditions, our circumstances, because we don't want to give up this, or we don't want to change that, or we don't want to do these things because we don't feel like we have to or should have to. You don't. But you'll want to if you truly love Him. God's love's not for sale. His promise is the same today as it was yesterday. It will be forever. It is up to us to focus our faith on Him, trust Him, clothe ourselves in Him so that people see that we identify with Him, that we are imitating Him, that we are a new person because of Him. That's what it means to prove God's love. And I hope that's true for you. You pray with me. Father, it is always a challenge. It is always a challenge to be reminded of the little things that I do that rebel against You. The little things I do to try to make up for wrongs that I've done, to make my faith performance-based, as if works can somehow make up for all the dumb things I've done. When all I really need to do is hold on to the promise that You made. Yes. That Your grace and Your love is free. And my response to that should be loving You back, honoring You with my life, respecting You in every way possible, trusting You, following You, giving up things I want to hold on to because ultimately I know that none of that will ever satisfy like You will. The promise to be an heir of everything that You have at my fingertips is just mind-boggling, and I pray that everybody here gets that. To be considered one of Your own, the greatest gift we could possibly imagine. May each and every person here focus their trust on You and You alone. We pray all that in Jesus' name. Amen.